I think it's always difficult as a player, especially with the relationship I had with Millwall and the fans, to leave, because you want to do so much more for the club. And at that time, there wasn't really any massive investment into buying more players to try and get promoted to the Premier League. And at that time, I was ready. In the times before, when I'd been approached, I'd always been a bit hesitant because I was like, I need the right club. I need the right environment for me. So when the time come to speak to clubs, you know, Everton were there knocking, and I'll never forget it because I met David Moyes and Bill Kenwright, and it was probably the best thing I'd ever done because they had a player that just wanted to play, and then they wanted to sign me because of everything they'd seen. But still, I reckon, a little bit unsure with what they were going to get. But, you know, the only question I asked David Moyes when we're in the office is, are you going to give me my opportunity? And he looked at me and he went, well, we're signing your son. And I went, no. Look, am I going to get the opportunity to play and start or to be involved? He says, yeah, you'll get your opportunity. And I looked at my agent at the time and I said, that's enough for me then. I said, I knew straight away. So it suited me perfect to go to Everton. Just before I'd signed there, there were question marks because the fans were like, Tim Cahill, proven, but, you know, what type of player are we getting? Because it wasn't a massive transfer fee. I think what made it worse is Wayne Rooney leaving after I signed. But I was looking at the players, Duncan Ferguson, David Weir, Alan Stubbs, Lee Carsey, Tommy Gravison, Kevin Kilbane, these types of characters, players, men, you know, men. When I played for Millwall, I played with men, you know, like Stuart Nethercott and Kim Grant, Jimmy Carter. Like, you know, I was a young kid amongst men who all had families. So it was sort of like a similar changing room. The fans, very passionate. It's got history. It's got belief. I knew early on that I had to be aggressive. I had to be a leader. I had to work harder. I had to do extra. It was my second game, I think it was, and I'd scored the Tony Hibbert cross, header back the same way it come from, something that I'd done, you know, in training my whole life and throughout my career already. And then celebrating after already receiving yellow card and putting my top over my head, I was in shock. You know, I literally put it up, put it down, and I was so happy. It's my first ever goal. And it was just at the time then when they made a rule that if you put your shirt over your head, that you'd get caution. And it was the longest time of my life sitting on the bench waiting for the whistle to blow, because it didn't hinder the game or the points. But I got ridiculed more than anything for just hugging the manager after I'd scored and running to him, and not with the players. But it was the longest wait ever, but also a very special moment for myself. That's what I waited my whole life for. I knew that I could impact that football club because of the football club that I was at, what I'd learned, what I understood, what players had left with me, what managers, what fans had instilled in me. I knew very early on with David Moyes, his discipline. I had the opportunity to play with Duncan Ferguson, Alan Stubbs, Tony Hibbert, three massive Evertonians. I can name more, the list can go on, but very early on I earned the respect of those three. And that counted a lot for that team. When we got each other on side, and Tony Hibbert taught me what it was to be an Evertonian through the time, and I just knew that something could happen. I didn't know how or if it was going to happen, but I knew it was going to be more positive. And we got our first derby win in ages. So the constant theme through my career has been just try. Like, let's just get us together. Let's form a belief. And with what we've got, if the ingredients can work tactically, technically, and the fundamentals are all correct, it all comes down to the discipline and the attitude for the execution of finishing fourth. And I knew going to that club that they were here, and anything there, even mid-table, was a success. And they were the levels that I could build on to implement myself and introduce myself to the Premier League. Merseyside derby is everything for an Evertonian and a Liverpudlian. They live for that game. You know, they go to work Monday to Friday for their football. They're passionate. And those moments that I had at Anfield, you know, scoring was the only way that you can make an impact on those fans, my fans and their fans. That's the only way. If you go to battle in any sort of way, the only way you can make an impact is not by talking to the fans or trying to entice them. It's what you do on the pitch and even at Goodison Park. So it's an opportunity as a player to leave your mark. It's an opportunity to have something that you stand for, but even now I miss them. That's probably one of the biggest things I miss about football, because it's a time that you can activate the fan in a whole different way. It takes them to another world that they live and they hold on to this, not weeks, not months. They hold on to it near enough forever. Favourite Liverpool players to play against in Merseyside derbies, without a doubt, Steven Gerrard. I used to look for his name straight away. If you want any bigger character that has an influence through actions and not talking, it's him. One tackle, one pass, one shot, one run, their behaviours. Their behaviours that become infectious on players, and there's something that there's not many players that I would say that have that impact within a game. The other player I'd look for is Jamie Carragher, because he'll be the first one that I'll target to have a meeting with on the pitch when the ball comes in, second ball into the body, and expect contact or expect, you know, a coming together. Because if you can win those sorts of battles with characters like that, it does have effect on their fans, because he is definitely one of the biggest leaders for that club, is Steven Gerrard. And probably one of the best players to watch, Xavi Alonso. Short, long, it was like you had the ball on a string with the way he passes. So big influential sort of players, but two for me is Steven Gerrard and Jamie Carragher. David Moyes has a very stern character, strong, tall, and not intimidating, but just when he comes into the room, you know he's there. He cares about the players, even though sometimes he doesn't show it. He cares about the group, but I think one of the best things that he done for the football club was build a team around the club's identity, what it meant to play for the club, what it meant to the fans. He's one of the best I've worked with, because not just about the football, it's about the family side. You know, he always asked how my family was. He always asked how I was mentally. And he always knew how to push my buttons. You know, he's not someone that would compliment me a lot, but would give me constructive criticism that will create a spark to hit a nerve to try and do better, because I know that I can give him more. And he could get everything out of a player, which, you know, signing Mikel Arteta, Stephen Pienaar, Leighton Baines, Jagielka, Phil Neville, Fellaini, the list can go on. And he was very good at putting good characters and good people together and giving us responsibility within that group to help him on and off the pitch, but very detailed. Very detailed. Like, you know, now wanting to become a coach and transitioning into learning how to be a coach, the attributes that I'll never forget with him was analysis, was being in that media room for hours, was being on the pitch on a Friday or Thursday. And we joke about it now, having to get wet tops and put them on, because we're walking through set plays. And we knew where we had to stand on set plays, arm width apart, body shape, a little bit open, and then looking to where we were going to head it and how we were going to break on transition from a corner, the importance of defence. But the detail that he had, he doesn't get a lot of credit for. And I don't think that he'd really ask for it, because with what we had to finish fourth, he made the players, all these players that he had, he made better players. They went on and had amazing moves and resurrected some of their careers. Who knows, you know, if we had, you know, could sign, you know, more players or spend loads of money, what it would be like. I think when you talk about Mikel and Phil into coaching, different coaches altogether, different personalities, and also different styles to a certain degree, different sorts of leaders. You know, Mikel's quiet, introverted, only speaks when there's something important to say. The analysis side of what he does and the detail in behind is on a different planet. And you look at Phil Neville, it's actions, it's voice, it's pointing, it's organising, it's more collective. I think for where Mikel's sitting now as a coach, his character, I think he's going to be very successful. And I know as a close friend, not because we played together and I'm a fan, I know because of being in the same changing room as him, being on the same pitch. Things that don't matter to other players or to other people, whether it's in a training session or whether it's in a video or whether it's on paper, the hours is the most important thing, is what you put into anything. And one of the biggest things he said to me that will never leave me is that what you put in is what you'll get back when you want to become a coach. And hence, you know, the level that I'm putting behind learning, understanding the educational side, the technical, the tactical, the grassroots, and being within academy. But I can only sit from afar and watch him and know that the hours he's putting in and the work rate is second to none.